have had a great week. I know you guys are in your third or fourth week of school. Some of you guys are still homeschooling. But this week started back our Tuesday night Kids Life Groups and Wednesday Kids Life Groups with PE and tutoring. So if that is something that you're interested in, we would love to have you. And if you're not able to come in person, we do have Zoom meetings available that you can connect through Zoom and you can be part of our Tuesday night and you can be part of our Wednesday morning. So we didn't see anybody Zoom this week, but that is an option for you if you can't come. So it went really, really well this week. And if you weren't able to make it, I hope that we can see you next week. Well, this morning, we are going to start off with our expectations. Can you guys tell me our three expectations that we have? That's right, obedience is one, being kind is one, and being helpful. Do you guys remember the difference between being obedient and being helpful? That's right, obedient is doing something when you're asked to do it and you do it right away. And being helpful is doing something that you weren't even asked to do. So you guys are so smart. You just get smarter and smarter. And Miss Lori and I can't wait to see you in person if you haven't been here yet. And this morning, we are going to do prayer time. And how many of you guys remember the candle on the screen downstairs in the kids' service? We have that little candle. Do you guys remember what that represents? It's the Holy Spirit. So we're going to open up in prayer. And then when I finish praying, we're going to be quiet for just a few moments. And you're going to listen to see if you hear the Holy Spirit talk. And Miss Lori and I would love to hear from you, to hear any of your God stories, or if the Holy Spirit is teaching you something. We want to hear from you. So have your parents send us a video or a message. You can text or email, because we want to know what God is teaching you. Since we haven't been able to be together, all together, we miss you, and we miss knowing what God is doing in your lives. So why don't we open up in prayer, and then Miss Lori is going to come up, and she's going to explain to you what we're doing and why we're here today. So let's start with prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to be able to have this technology, to do our lessons with kids. God, we continue to pray for the kids that are doing school. Maybe they're doing Zoom. Maybe they're doing homeschool and things are different. But we just pray a blessing over all of these families and these children because you love them, God. You love them so much, and you want the very best for them. And we pray over this time this morning as Miss Lori comes, and she's going to share with us from your word and the scripture. And that is so exciting, God. And we just thank you for this opportunity to serve you and come to you. Amen. All right, friends, Miss Lori is going to come up and she's going to teach our lesson today.
Hi, friends. I am so glad to see you again, and I am so glad to get to learn with you. So you remember the last several weeks we've been working our way through the book of Mark. It's the second book in the New Testament. It is one of the four Gospels, and Mark was not one of the 12 disciples. Remember, he was really young, and he wrote all of this after the fact, after Jesus ascended into heaven, and he was trying to prove one thing. Do you remember what he was trying to prove? He was trying to prove to the Jewish people and to others that Jesus really was the Messiah. And today in our Bible time together, our study time together, we're going to be looking at Mark chapter 14. So you can go ahead and get there, okay? And what am I standing in front of? Yeah, the cross. I'm in the big worship center at church, and I'm standing in front of the cross because it's not something we look at a whole lot to think about. We look at it, but we don't always think about it. And today we're looking at it because we're going to be thinking about the sacrifice that Jesus made. And it wasn't just one, it was multiple. So open your Bibles with me to Mark chapter 14. I have to have my notes today because you're going to learn some Greek in a minute. Okay, chapter 14, starting at verse 32. Oh, no, we're not. I'm going to remind you of where we are in context, okay? So last week, you remember, we were learning, and Jesus came in, and we call it the triumphal entry or Palm Sunday, and he came into Jerusalem, and he came in riding on that they were putting the leaves down and stuff, and he was preparing them that he was a different kind of leader. Remember? That he was human, and he's a person just like us, but he's not just like us, because he's the Son of God, right? So he was preparing them that he's different. And then he went to the temple the next day, and he had a throwdown, right? He was flipping the tables, but do you remember why? And he cracked the whip. But when he was angry, he didn't sin. But why did he do that? What were they taking the space up of? Yeah, they were taking the space of the people to worship. It wasn't bad that they were selling the animals to sacrifice. It was bad if they were charging too much money because they could. But it's not bad they were there. They were providing something that was needed. But they needed to do that outside the temple area, because where they were was in the courtyard where people of all the nations were supposed to be able to come and worship God. And Jesus came in and he was preparing them, preparing their brains and their hearts to understand the difference between Jesus and this new promise and the old rules. There were all the rules on how to do things right and get it done the right way. And they were so concerned about rules. And he's like, stop it. Don't be so concerned about having the right animal to sacrifice that you keep people from being able to even worship. So that happened. And then you remember a few days later, those guys, they stopped him and they were trying to ask him tricky questions. You remember? To see if they could get him to answer in a way that they could then arrest him or say he was guilty of something. And they asked him and they said, What's the biggest commandment? What's the most important commandment? And Jesus was like, trick me, whatever, I am God, right? Okay, he didn't say that. I'm certain he thought it. Okay, I'm not certain he thought it. I think he probably thought it. So he goes, oh, easy peasy, lemon squeezy. He didn't say that either. He said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the next commandment is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. He says, in those simple words, he goes, you know what, guys? All the hundreds of rules that God gave you in how to worship and obey him correctly, then you added all your hundreds of rules to it, right? I'm going to boil it down to three so it's easy for you guys to remember and easy for us to remember. Love God with your whole self. Love you, yourself, because God made you amazing. And love others all the time, right? So he said all that, and this is the week before he comes into the cross. So now he's there, and they've had the Last Supper. Do you guys remember? They were there, and they were having the Passover feast together. This was a feast they had every year, the Jewish people had every year, and it was a big, big, big deal. And Jesus had just celebrated Passover with and feast with his disciples, and it became what we now call the Last Supper or the Lord's Supper, right? Because this was the last time Jesus celebrated Passover on earth. And during that meal, during that time, Jesus told them, I'm going to die. And that's when he broke the bread and he said, this is my body. He said, this is a new commandment I give to you. This is my body broken for you. This is my blood pouring out for you. And they took all that and they were kind of confused and like, what are you talking about? And then Jesus tells Judas to go ahead and leave and go betray him. And they're walking to the Garden of Gethsemane because Jesus wants to go pray. And Jesus is still preparing them. And he's like, I'm going to die, but I'm going to come back. And Peter's like, no way, man. I'm not going to let anybody kill you. They'll have to kill me to get to you. You know Peter with his mouth, right? He talks. I do that too. He talks when he's nervous. He talks when he doesn't understand sometimes. And Jesus goes, Peter, not only are you going to deny me, not only are you going to walk away from me, you're going to do it three times before morning, before the rooster crows. And then they get to the Garden of Gethsemane, which means olive grove. It's where all the olive trees are growing. So you can imagine that it was beautiful, right? And this is where we pick up in chapter 14, verse 32. So now, sorry guys, I like to talk. tell you the story. We're there. Jesus and his disciples went to a place called Gethsemane. Jesus said to them, "Sit here while I pray." And he took Peter and James and John along with him. So most of the disciples stayed in one area, and then he walked further into the garden, into the trees to have more space or something. And then he takes Peter, James, and John with him. And you remember, those are the same three that went on the mountain with him for the transfiguration, right? So they're coming with him. Those are his three really close friends. He's like, "I really need you guys." He says, "Come with me further." And he says this. He began to be very upset and troubled. "My soul is very sad. I feel close to death," he said to them. "Stay here and watch." He went a little further. Then he fell to the ground and he prayed that if possible, this hour might pass him by. "Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup of suffering away from me. But let what you want done be done." And you can read the rest of that on your own. But I want to look at some interesting things in there. First, I'm going to teach you Greek. Because Pastor Mark's teaching your parents Greek, and I think it's silly when people think the kids can't learn the same thing. So here we go. Here's Greek. Miss Robin just taught me how to say these words. So if you already know Greek and I said it wrong, you can tell me in the comments how to say it correctly. So when Jesus says back here in verse 33, he says he began to be very upset and troubled. The Greek there is actually ekthembeo. Ekthembeo, and it means amazingly horrible. He's feeling so bad. Like it's a horrible day. It's worse than that. It's amazingly horrible. And then in the next verse it says, "My soul is very sad. I feel close to death." The Greek there is paralupos, intense grief. Grief is a huge sadness related to loss. So you're sad when something's not there anymore. And Jesus is feeling these huge feelings. He's not a little bit sad. He's not a little bit concerned. It's huge. It's amazingly horrible. He knows what's going to happen. He knows because he says, "Father," when he prays, he says, "Father, if something else can happen, please let it happen. If saving all of the people of the world can be done a different way, that would be great." Is what Jesus is praying. And he says, "But if it can't, then I will do it." And for a long time, I thought Jesus was only worried about how awful his trial and his death would be, which were both bad. I mean, you remember, they take him, the Pharisees do, and the Sadducees do, and they put him on trial. They come to the garden, like this Gethsemane, like right after this, and they get him, and they take him to be tried, and they lie. That's something to feel amazingly horrible about. But there's more. And this is the thing that I tend to forget, and that's why I'm teaching this in front of the cross, because many Christian churches, in the way that I grew up, we celebrate so much. Jesus didn't stay dead. He rose again. We serve a living Savior. God is alive. Jesus is alive. Holy Spirit lives in me, and that's amazing. And I forget what he gave up. I just kind of go cross and death part because it's kind of gross. But guys, sometimes we gotta think about that part. Jesus experienced something for the first time in his eternal God life and human life. He knew he was going to experience the disapproval, the punishment from God for sin. Because when he died, when he went on the cross, he took my sin, my bad choices. He took yours. He took everybody in the world with him. So you know, do you know that feeling that sometimes when you decide to make a bad choice, when you decide to sin, and then you do it, and just in your gut, you're like, oh, that was a bad call. And you just feel bad. Imagine that feeling. Because that's the Holy Spirit telling you, you need to repent. That was a bad choice. You need to make a better choice and apologize. Imagine that feeling, except for every time you did that in your entire life, all at one time, that feeling, plus that feeling for everybody in the entire world ever. That's what he was taking on. He took on that feeling, the sin, the displeasure of God, God being unhappy and going, I can't be near you. For the first time in his life, and when he did, because he never sinned, when he took that on, he didn't take it on for just him. He took it on for everyone. That's a big deal, guys. But the other thing we need to remember is he didn't have to. He chose to. He chose to feel that awful feeling. He chose to die and go to hell and defeat Satan because he loves you. Because he loves me. Because he loves your brothers and sisters and parents and grandparents and cousins and aunts and uncles and the people who live across the street and across the world. Because he loves us, he chose to feel that. To experience that. And it's a big deal that we think about that. And so sometimes, kind of like not teaching kids Greek words, we don't like to leave kids or adults thinking about the hard stuff. But you know what, guys? You can handle it. So I want you to think about this today. I want you to think about how much love Jesus showed you by choosing to experience that amazingly horrible experience. And if you haven't made the decision to ask Jesus to forgive your sin, to forgive your bad choices, and be your boss forever, we can talk. That is the most important decision you'll ever make, because that's what makes Jesus' gift of his taking that horribleness on him on the cross from being for everybody to you taking it. Because that gift is there. It's for every single person in the whole world. But you have to take it. You have to accept it by asking Jesus to forgive you and be your boss. He wants you to do that. No, when you ask, he says, yes, I'm so glad you asked. So if you haven't done that yet, maybe that's what you need to think about right now. But guys, I love you, and I know this was a hard one. And if you want to keep thinking about this, you can read Mark.
read chapter 14, verses 32, all the way through 15, chapter, or just through all of chapter 15. While you think about it. And don't forget, Jesus chose this. Nobody made him. Jesus chose this for love for you and me. And we need to value that. So friends, I'm going to pray and we're going to be done, okay? God, thank you. Thank you. I don't deserve Jesus' choice. But Jesus chose me. He chose love as more important than what was comfortable for him. And God, I ask that you would help them to make that decision to follow you and accept your forgiveness. And anybody that my alarm just distracted because Satan didn't want them to hear, I bind back Satan in the name of Jesus. God, if there is a child or an adult who needs to ask you right now for forgiveness and ask you to be their Lord forever, then God, give them the courage to do so. Thank you for choosing love. In Jesus' name I pray.